I am Gérald Fenoy from Geolabs company, and I am co-author only of this talk. I have as a co-author Nicolas Boson, Venkatesh Raghavan for Osaka City University, Rémi Cresson, which is present in the room actually, Benoît Hirou, which passed away earlier this year, unfortunately, and Jean-Christophe Desconnet, which were both working on the HPC support in the Zoo project that I will introduce to you. So the idea of the Zoo project. The Zoo project is, first of all, C and C++ implementation software of the WPS standard published by the OGC. It is available on the internet, and the initial idea was to create some kind of protocol bus in between all the OSGeo library or the OSGeo software that are already available and providing a lot of services already, and simply find a way to use every tools in the single manner. This is where the WPS came into picture. So the idea born in 2008 during the Phosphor-G in South Africa. This is why we have this kind of color and the baobab tree, which is coming from the Senegal. Then we have the full history of the Zoo project with the first talk in Sydney. And then we tried to make a release for every single Phosphor-G all over the year. As you can see, during the last 4 years, we slowed down a bit, because when you reach a given level of quality in your software, you don't need much more effort and much more release, because it is simply working. So I will quickly introduce you who is taking the decision within the project. So it is the project steering committee. Then I will introduce to you the committer of the project, let's say the list of the developers that are providing support, code, and everything for the Zoo project. Then we also, you can notice that we love to give a new name for everything. We give new name for everything, so the project steering committee, the tribal council, and so on and so forth. Here on the left, you can see a few people with a Zoo t-shirt, like my amazing children, and Francois Merdam also on the right. Here is a list of the tribal council with Nicolas Bonzo again, Maria Brovelli, that everybody knows, Massimiliano Canata, myself, Hirofumi Hayashi, Daniel Castell, Jeff McKenna, Marcus Nettler, Venkatesh Raghavan, and Angelos Tsostos, which is one of the PCSW implementers. Here you have a picture of faces of the PSC. Only Hayashi and Daniel Castell are missing. It was in a Phosphor-G Europe, I cannot remember where. Then you have here the list of the committers, so Nicolas Boson, Trevor Clark, Rémi Cresson, Luca De Lucchi, myself, and one of the most valuable contributors, which is Knut Landmark, Jeff McKenna too. I will speak about him a bit more in the next slide. Marco Negretti, Marcus Nettler, David Saggiorato, and Angelos Tsostos. We have links with plenty of universities that we are commonly naming them our knowledge partners. So our knowledge partners are responsible to create curriculum for their students, and the student will learn the project and will implement their own services. So it helps also the project to get feedback from the user community and to make workshops also locally in every of these universities. So we have the Graduate School of Academic of Science in China, SUPSI, which is where Massimiliano Canata is working. Here we have the Nareswan University, where we have led a workshop on MapMint and MapMint for me. Laboratorio di Geomatica, Osaka City University, and Fondazione Moonmac from Italy. Unfortunately, you may notice that I come from France, but no French university was supporting the Zoo project by now. Obviously, as it is an open source project, you can contribute yourself, so you can join the mailing list, have direct contact with us on IRC, do bug tracking. You can also make a language support internally inside the Zoo kernel or for the Zoo services also. You can provide new WPS services. You can also contribute doc, because we are not very good in not in public in publicity, let's say, and also in documentation. And you can also directly provide simply traduction using the Transifex. It means that you don't need to ask anybody to contribute. You simply have to connect to Transifex, and you will be able to translate the internal messages of the Zoo kernel or the messages from the Zoo services. So I already spoke about kernel and services, but you are not aware of what is it about. So here are the four main components of the Zoo project. So first, we have the Zoo kernel, which has been implemented in C. Why we have implemented it in C? Because we did not want to be stuck in any programming languages, and we want to be able to handle any kind of programming languages, which is actually what we are doing now. Then you have some Zoo services, which means that you have chosen a programming language and you have implemented your services. I will show you a few lines of code, and I can show you also how with two lines of code you can define a new services. So even my children can make a new services, WPS services available. Then you have this WPS API, which was initially only available in the JavaScript world, and I will go in deeper details later on. And then you have the WPS client, which is not a JavaScript API that is running on the server side, but it is this time running on the client side, and it will ease the interaction in between your web browser and the WPS server. So the Zoo kernel is a C application, as I told you. It is running as a CGI. It is supporting WPS1, WPS2, 100%. It runs obviously on every operating system because it has been written on C, so it is most easy to port on every single operating system. You can implement your services because it is supporting to handle execution of C, C++, Fortran code, Java, PHP, Perl, Ruby, Python, C#, JavaScript, and R. What was unfortunate at that stage when we were only supporting programming languages, it was that people have to still write some codes to make their WPS services available. So we were thinking to ourselves, oh, maybe we have also plenty of applications that may have been implemented properly, like GrassJS or Photobox and SagaJS. When I say implemented properly, I mean they have internally some kind of catalog, so you can extract all the metadata information from this catalog, and you can publish actually with our own tool, simply the Zoo configuration file, but I will explain to you a bit in deeper details what are the Zoo configuration file later on. So here are some examples of 10 years old application we have made because the Zoo kernel is able for every services which is returning GIS data, which can be a raster result or a vector result. It can publish automatically using the map server C API your data using WMS, WFS or WCS depending on the type of your output. So here you have an example where we simply run a PG routing request. Here you have the WMS, which is used to show the shortest path, but the safest path. And here done, you have the profile, elevation profile, and on the right side, you have the WFS request for the same WMS feature. So it means that you execute once your service, you can display it on a map, you can display the details, and you can reuse this WFS as an input to provide the profile elevation profile. Also, you may be aware that in WPS, you can run your execute request synchronously or asynchronously. In WPS2, they have added the get status request. At that time, in WPS1, there were no the get status request, so we simply implemented a get status service, which is able to do the exact same thing as a get status request, which means that you can have a loading bar. This application is 7 years old ago. You can have a loading bar, which is meaning really something, and which make the client application really aware of what is the step the service is running, that is running back, is doing right now. You have also in WPS2 the nested input and nested output. In release 1.7.0, the support is far better than in the previous one. Also in the new release, we have the security section because sometimes your WFS or WCS is secured and you can define what are the header with this attribute and this security block, what are the header you want to let pass, like such as authorization, or to simply pass the authentication of the user. The last but not least implementation that has been made is the HPC support, which means that you have the Zoo kernel, which is running on a web server, and you have your HPC server, which is hosting Orfeo Toolbox application. And then the Zoo kernel is simply, when it receives from a proxy actually an execute request, it will send the data. It will also publish in Elasticsearch, but let's say it simply uploads the data, create some kind of script that will be added to the scheduler in the queue. Then the Slurm will execute this task. When the task is over, we will receive an email. This email will be read by a simple daemon written in Python, read this email, and then inform the Zoo kernel that the process succeeded or failed. And then the Zoo kernel will fetch the error log in case of error, or simply the result. And the rest of the process is exactly the same than for other things, means that you can publish also automatically your data through WMS, like we can see in this picture. So this is the GeoSuite project where Rémi was involved in. So lately I went in London where I've heard about this processing API, which is based on OpenAPI. And from my point of view, it means that WPS is dead, from what I have learned with this OpenAPI. Obviously, we have implemented it before going in London, so we have the processing API or API processes or WPS3 or whatever is the name you want to give to him. So hopefully with our implementation you won't have to modify one line of code in your services, because we want to be the abstract level and don't want to bother the developer. So here actually when the slides are online, so you can simply click on these images to see the user interfaces. I have also published a report on this OGC hackathon. And I would like to thank specifically Benjamin Pross, and I think every WPS implementer should thank him for all the work he has made with this WPS REST binding, because when I met with him in London, I realized that nobody has given him any help, even an expert like we can be, for this work. And so he tried his best to implement everything and to define everything in the specification, but still there is some lack, so maybe we should help him. Anyway, it was just to present to you this also user interface, which is client of PyGeo API, made by Tom Kralidis and Angelos Tsostos, I think also. And just, what is your, just, okay. So in this case, we are simply a client of WFS3, and we are running WPS3 on top of this WFS3 feature. So then we go to the Zoo services. So Zoo services in the Zoo project is a couple of the metadata configuration. So what are the input, what are the output, so things like that. So you can use our own format using the Zoo configuration file, or you can also use YML. And now in 1.7.0 version, metadata of the every single services can also be stored in a relational database. And the idea is still to convert any existing code simply, the more simple possible, as a WPS services. So here you have a very stupid example of the LOPY. So in LOPY you can see that we are only giving three parameters. The main configuration file, let's say the environment, because also when the service is running it is fetching all the environment information and it is passing this information to the service code. Then you have the input, the output, and the only thing you have to do is to put your to add a value key inside your output and put whatever you want in this, and then return if the service succeeded or failed. So as Einstein said, keep it simple, stupid. With this Zoo project, when you install Zoo project and you have already Saga GIS and Orfeo Toolbox, then you will have 500 more ready to use WPS services. Also, we started initially by implementing every GIDAL command line tool that you are using, like OJR to OJR, GIDAL translate, GIDAL wrap, and everything like this, as WPS services. But we did that work 12 years ago, and the code is still working nowadays with the last test version of GIDAL. Same we did with SIGAL, for mainly for triangulation. Then we got some support about GrassGIS. For Orfeo Toolbox, the last version is supporting 6.6.1, version 6.6.1 of Orfeo Toolbox, 7.2, so the very last Saga GIS version. And also some JSOC was made in 2016 and is available on GitHub just to prove that indeed you can implement the bus vector operation using the GIDAL and the underlying GEOS library, but you can also do the same with the GeoTool. So we just made this Google Summer of Code to prove that you can do the same thing using C library or Java library. Then you have this Zoo API. This Zoo API is based on SpiderMonkey because the Zoo kernel is relying on SpiderMonkey to execute services that have been implemented in JavaScript. Right, so you can run services in JavaScript, and from this JavaScript source code, you can also invoke any kind of other existing services. So, from your, if you don't know anything about programming and you want to write all your code in JavaScript, you can do this, and then you can use our internal Zoo kernel function that has been exposed to the JavaScript world. Use this function and invoke, for instance, one Orfeo Toolbox application, then one Python application, then one C application, then one Fortran application if you are very mathematician, and you can chain all this, but you don't chain only like you can do with WPS1 and embed the execute request as an input for another execute request. Here you can also add logics in between every processing. So here are some examples of the MapMint1 version where we were using this JavaScript API. Here is another example of the georeferencer which was made available online 10 years ago. Then we have the Zoo client. The Zoo client is a JavaScript API, one more time, but which this time it is not working on the server side. It is working from your web browser, and it is the writing of execute request or get capability or describe process, and also is the parsing of the result. It is a logicless moustache. It is based on a logicless moustache template. It has been made in 2015, and it is still working right now. So here you got an example of how it can be used, how it was used in Publica Mundi, an European project. Then here you have the famous Saga demonstration that you can have, you will have on your OSGeo Live. So it means that from actually this demonstration, I like it a lot because even the form to input the data and everything has been generated on the fly, depending on the result of the describe process. So if the Orfeo Toolbox application take a new input, automatically the form will add this new input and will let you fill a value for this new input. Also, if you choose the image PNG, then it will use the map server automatic publication, and the result will be obviously shown on the map. Here is another example which is using the exact same principle to automate the generation of the form, which is available online and on your OSGeo Live, and it is running the Orfeo Toolbox application. This is another example of what we used actually when Zoo client born. It is using it depends on require.js, so it means that every JavaScript will be loaded dynamically. So we had to re-implement MapMint almost from scratch. And this is the MapMint2 version, where you can see the city of Dakar in Senegal. Here is one more time the georeferencer that I shown you in MapMint1, which is also available, obviously, in MapMint version 2. And this is another example where you can simply classify your raster data. Then this has been made also in 2015. This was a SICAN integration of WPS, meaning that from within your catalog, you were able to use WPS services as a first class data in the catalog. And obviously, you are accessing your service WPS services from within the catalog. So the data is coming also from within the catalog, and the data once the service has been executed will be stored directly inside the catalog. So here you have an example of the SIGAL triangulation I was speaking about earlier. Also, we have a Zoo project for Windows. So we have an ongoing test of the compilation using this AppVeyor. So we thank AppVeyor for this work. Also, we want specifically thanks Jeff McKenna for his hard work with this MS4W, which means MapServer4W. And in this MapServer4W, some people were asking him to integrate the C# support of the Zoo project within the Windows version. And nowadays, it is available in the 1.7 dev package of the Zoo project, which is available in the brand new MS4W that was released earlier this week. So on top of this Zoo project, which is already, I hope you understand, an amazing software, we have built up a GIS SDI, so some kind of user interface, because I think in 2019 it is also nice to have a user interface to interact with your WPS services and ease the work, ease the communication, the use of any software using this. So we built up this MapMint product, and I finish my presentation. So if you have any questions, thank you for your attention. And if you have any question, I'm open to answer any. Sorry.
Sorry for interruption. Yeah, so thank you for being on time. Questions? You need a mic.
No.
Ah, yeah, cool.
So I have some question. Some technical questions. First, I saw that in HPC you choose to inform the server that the task is ready by mail. Why?
I failed in my explanation. We are using SSH, right? We connect through SSH to the HPC server. Then we have produced already a SBatch. This SBatch is uploaded on the server on the HPC side. Mm-hmm. Then we connect through this HPC, mm-hmm. again using SSH, and we add this SBatch to the Slurm queue. So we are using only SSH. Then in HPC and in Slurm, you can say if the service failed or if the service succeed, then you can send an email back when the task is over. Not at the beginning of the task,
okay.
Sorry.
Okay, right, yeah, when the task is over. Okay, so mail it's okay, I guess, but perhaps a messaging service or something like that would be faster, and you don't need to pull it or to do anything, it's just a publish subscribe?
No, we are not connecting again back to the HPC, because the HPC is responsible to run the task. And okay, Slurm is reliable enough to make sure that we will get some information back that the task failed or succeeded.
Okay, so basically you just said that okay, mail it's enough, it's doing its job, okay.
Honestly, we did not choose this actually. The client has chosen to use the email thing. So.
And how come SpiderMonkey and not V3 or something else?
Excuse me?
Why SpiderMonkey and not V3 or something else for JavaScript?
Well, because at that time when we implemented this JavaScript support, V8 was not existing actually. And only SpiderMonkey was available, and also we were thinking that as Firefox is one XPCOM, one of the most famous XPCOM use, we were thinking at the beginning that we may also make Zoo kernel running directly within your browser. And actually back in 2012 or 2011, we got the Zoo kernel working directly within your browser, which means that you can run from the console of your XPCOM component, you can run the services locally, or you can run the almost same, using the almost same syntax but changing the host name, the same service remotely. Mm-hmm. And we were thinking that maybe it can be a revolution for every single software. For instance, let's imagine that in QGIS you have something like this nowadays available. So it may mean that if your QGIS is able, if your computer is able to process the big data you want to process, then you can run this service locally. But if your computer is not enough powerful to run your service, then you may ask another server to run the exact same task. So I think it may be some kind of revolution. Sorry. Thank you very much.